Hey, we're Allie and AJ.
And this is The First Time.
The first time that we found out potential breakup song was blowing up on TikTok was probably through our girlfriends.
Through our friends. I think Valerie specifically.
Yeah, Valerie and Chelsea, two of our friends who kept messaging us
TikTok videos.
And we were so confused. We didn't really know what was going on yet. And then our manager really informed us, guys, like something's happening here and we should maybe get more involved on the platform. But we didn't even have TikToks at that point in time.
Yeah.
We were still living under a rock a little bit.
But weeks went by where friends would just message us funny videos that were going viral. And we were like, whoa, the song is getting like a whole new life. What's going on?
It was very random.
It's crazy. But and it really wasn't even like a reunion or like there was nothing that really sparked it. It's just that one video took off and then the rest just followed.
The first time we got involved with Disney was thanks to me, actually.
Yes.
It was because I ended up booking a TV show with them called Phil of the Future.
Phil!
It was my first job. That's how I got my SAG card. Everything kind of went wrong on the day of the audition, which is kind of interesting. They wanted me to actually straighten my hair. I had, you know, kind of wavy. I have naturally wavy, semi-curly hair. And so a woman from like the Disney offices gave me like pomade and so my hair was basically like greasy for the audition.
Because you had to flatten it out.
I need to flatten it out.
Oh,
but I booked it. And then that led to us getting signed with Hollywood Records, which was a part of the whole Disney family.
I couldn't book a Disney show to save my life. I auditioned for Disney shows constantly.
I feel like you auditioned a lot, yeah.
And I literally, I remember like I would get a call back and then never, like could not book a Disney job. And then finally we ended up doing the movie together, Capitals.
Yeah. But. Yeah. Oh my gosh.
The first time we recorded a TikTok with our mom is the only time we've recorded a TikTok with our mom. And we never will again.
She was very nervous.
She was
she
so nervous.
She made us do a lot of takes. I mean, we actually did quite good because we did some rehearsal beforehand. And we made the movements really easy and simple for her.
She ended up doing a great job, but it took a while. Like this was last November during her birthday. And we were like, Mom, we got to do a My Stupid Birthday TikTok with you. She was thrilled, but she was also like, I don't really want to be on camera. Is there any way we could cut me out? I'm like, no, we can't just use your
body.
Like
you being in it is
the whole point is mom and daughter. And so she finally like got comfortable and we did quite a few takes, but it was, I mean, Allie's husband shot it and the whole time he was just laughing. He was like,
it was ridiculous.
It's kind of iconic though. Cause we'll always have that with our mom, which is cute.
Yeah.
First time we made music together was in our music room that we had called the Candelabra Studios. Allie and I hadn't recorded music out of that studio because it was more of just like a practice space. But that's when we started like really working on our writing. Mm-hmm. We had started playing guitar in that room. We started, I think one of the first songs we ever wrote was No One, which was written in that room. No One. And we thought it was like really sweet to call it Candelabra Studios.
I have no idea why.
We had found these cool little candelabra stands and we like had like a whole mood in the room and like rugs out and like a big sign that Allie drew that said Candelabra. And like, so weird. Like, I don't even know how.
I have no idea where that came from.
Me
but
either.
We were very much into the vibe of like, this is our space. This is our musical.
Yeah.
This is our musical room.
But that room in particular, growing up in the Valley, like that room as a music room is kind of the first place where we started working on music. I think the first time we really stood up for ourselves or spoke out would have been with our old label, like the head of A&R that was working on the record. We were about to make our third record and we really wanted to kind of go a certain direction that was a bit more rock leaning. We had some producers lined up that we really wanted to work with. And
they kind of looked at us like,
they kind of thought it was
crazy. They'll never return your call, you know? And we just said, well, let's ask. And if they don't want to do the record, that's fine, but we might as well ask. And then
we got everybody,
which was kind of crazy
that we wanted.
But I feel like that was one of those moments where we were really determined to prove that we were real songwriters and real musicians, which was a rare thing at the label at that time. And that we were making music as females. I think that, you have this double standard as a woman making music in this business. It's much different than being a man. And it was us standing up for our art against, you know, 40-year-old white men. It was a good test at a very young age, but I think it gave us a lot of learning tools that we now use as adult women.
Yeah.
The first time we got involved with the Trevor Project was through our friend, Raymond Braun. And he's kind of just a shining light in our lives, and we adore him. And
he's literally like our other half. Like,
yeah.
He's right here.
He really is. And he's very much a teacher to AJ and I, especially when it comes to the LGBTQ plus community. And he was just talking about how much he respected the work that they were doing, mm-hmm. and that he thought that maybe we could get involved with them. And so we kind of did some brainstorming, and we decided that we would bring the Trevor Project out with us basically on tour.
We want to bring up that the Trevor Project is out on the road with us.
And we would have a number that people would be able to access live during our set that they could donate to. And that they also would be able to sign a petition to end conversion therapy as well on top of donating money. And it was just a really cool way to activate our fans right there in the moment. And then it kind of, I don't know, it kickstarted our relationship with Trevor Project. And so now we're kind of forever in the family with them. Gosh, I feel like first time we heard
that term, gay icons,
like around maybe like Sanctuary.
Yeah.
10 years.
I'd say 10 years. I think when we came back after like a really long hiatus for music and put out the 10 years EP, I think by that time, so many fans that had stuck with us for so long had now just blossomed, like either had come out or like felt comfortable with who they were, their sexuality. And so we started seeing that a lot on Twitter, like Allie and AJ are gay, gay icons.
And it just made us smile.
Yeah. It's so flattering. I mean, I feel like the first time was 10 years.
Yeah, I do. I think that's
like
probably
about
right. I mean, I'm sure there was a version of that when we were younger, that we were maybe a gay icon to a young kid, which is really sweet to think of. But we probably didn't even know that we had that kind of an impact on someone in middle America that was still positive. But it's neat to be able to meet our fans now and see how much they've been able to accept themselves, and that our music has maybe been able to be a small, tiny little part of that. It's really, really special. First time
I got
to the ball was with
Raymond Braun.
He's our teacher, like we said, of all things.
He introduced us to the show years ago, as well as Drag You. Allie and I just fell in love with the show. And I'm trying to think what season we really, really clicked with.
We were definitely watching it in our PJs. It was probably a slumber party situation.
Slumber party situation at his apartment. He was like, you gotta watch the show. You guys are gonna love it. You already love drag queens.
And then every time that we would get together, we would watch episodes. I think this is when it was still on
Logo.
It was very much the beginning. It was like, I think it was maybe the first or second season of it being on. And AJ and I were just hooked. And it's a wonderful outlet, and it's very creative. I feel
it's
like if you love creativity and drag queens and fashion, then this is a show made for you.
Yeah. I have so much respect.
Same. The first time we learned Simlish was, I think, actually in the studio. Like, we didn't have like prep time for that. They were just there teaching us how to say the words, and they had it all spelled out.
They had it typed out. Yeah. And we weren't Sim people. Like, we didn't have that game.
Yeah.
So we never, like, we weren't familiar with Sim language.
Yeah.
So we just hopped in the studio and had to sing it. And it was like, booty ba, boo da boo, ja ki da, zun ka da, ki da, bo bo bi da. Like, really
it was
weird.
So weird.